necesito un corillo para llevarte enredado. Solamente mi talento y DJ yo a mi lado.
Most of the rap singers come from the projects. They're from humble upbringings, but they're very smart kids. They're very smart kids, and they learn quickly.
In the barrio, in the suburb, they have, you know, to work hard and double to get their goals. They don't have the same facilities, the same helps from the people that upper classes or the people that go to the private school.
Yo todas las mañanas me regalo un paseo por el barrio, con el alma forrada de esperanza, desvelado por el sueño de mi hermano, porque lo conozco, porque lo viví, y porque soy un sobreviviente de las pesadillas que se viven cuando la sociedad o la necesidad nos prohíbe soñar, porque somos de barrio, tú sabes.
Quítate tú pa' ponerme yo, vamos a ver aquí quién es quién, después no digan que no se advirtió, son 12 que dan por 100. Quítate tú pa' ponerme yo, vamos a ver aquí quién es quién, después no digan que no se advirtió, son 12 que dan...
Yo creo que la economía informal en el país, gran porcentaje de esos 15 billones que se estima que es la economía informal, se debe al tráfico de drogas que hay en Puerto Rico.
In a country where the government actually doesn't really, 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 really take care seriously of all our needs, well, no wonder you have some sort of weird underground economy, you know? At least, anyway, the money's there. You know, these people are spending the money. They're moving it around. Somebody's children is eating of it. It's not like they're taking the money and they're sending it to Uruguay. It's here.
Lo que ha llevado a Puerto Rico a estar en la situación que estamos atravesando hoy en día han sido decisiones que se han tomado con el raciocinio político y no con el raciocinio económico. Y eso responde a que el secretario de Educación actualmente está preso por defalcar al Departamento de Educación unos actos de corrupción.
We're almost going to collapse economically because each government that's been in power has actually just been writing their own checks.
It was one government employee after the other being accused, and it turned into a circus because the two main political parties in Puerto Rico are always at each other's throats.
Compañeros, compañeros senadores, compañeras senadoras.
4 years they bicker, and then 4 years they go out, and then 4 years they bicker, and he who actually is not in power is bickering, and he who's in power is trying to do something, but at the same time is bickering, and they're finding out who's to blame for it, and telling you how to be afraid of it, but never finding out how to fix it. Puerto Rico is a tribal nation. That's why the music is so important. You see, that's why we and we all dance around the fire. And that expresses us. And that's who we are.
El africano nos dejó un tambor, como lo dejó en las diferentes islas del Caribe. En Cuba se dejó la rumba, se ha desarrollado la salsa.
There's a great relationship between the roots of salsa music in the 60s and 70s in New York and Puerto Rico and what happened later in the 90s. Because what happened with salsa is, originally it started as a very street-oriented, barrio-oriented music that was embraced by Puerto Ricans and Dominicans, but primarily Puerto Ricans in New York. What happened to salsa, though, was after about 10 years, the music became very detached from its roots and where it came from. In a big way, that killed salsa for people that really believed in it.
There was this whole world out there of kids who weren't embracing salsa and merengue the way their parents did.
Us as young kids, we lived in New York, you know. So yeah, we had the salsa and merengue and all that stuff. But let me say, Tito Puente did not influence me to become an MC.
That alienation from salsa and the roots of salsa is what opened the door for reggaeton to happen.
Y nosotros los puertorriqueños siempre tendemos a coger la música de afuera y hacerla nuestra. Porque nosotros tenemos una influencia americana. La influencia nuestra no viene de Puerto Rico al mundo, sino es del mundo hacia nosotros.
Ese tránsito entre Puerto Rico y Nueva York, en alguna medida, puede haber influenciado la producción musical, en este caso del reggaetón y el hip hop y el rap en español.
I was born right in the middle of the South Bronx. 1983. That's when everything started for me as a DJ. I was hearing Grandmaster Flash, Kool Herc, all those main guys when it come into the hip hop. And I said, wow, that's very interesting. How he could do mix one record to another. For me, it was exciting.
My name is Jorge Oquendo. I was originally born in South Carolina. My father is from Puerto Rico and my mother is from Spain. I come to Puerto Rico and my neighbor, he was starting to do parties and shows here in Puerto Rico. And he wanted to get into the rock and roll business, which was huge at the time. In the 80s, rock and roll was very huge. It was then that I told him, listen, there's a new kind of music going on in New York and in the United States. It's called hip hop, it's called rap. Bringing Poison was $125,000 for one night, you know? And with that, you could bring like three or four rappers to Puerto Rico.
At that time, it was merengue, salsa, and pop music and rock in Puerto Rico. There was not even one radio station that would play a rap record.
The owner of X100, Mr. Roberto Davila, and Baron Lopez, who was a DJ for that radio station, first played the rap music on the radio.
I said, let me do what no radio station has done in Puerto Rico. That is doing the hot mixes. Hot mixes, taking one song, re-edit it, special for the radio station.
In 1987, we were bringing down to Puerto Rico Public Enemy. And one day, this guy comes into our office asking us if he could open up for Public Enemy. And I said, who are you? And he says, oh, I'm DJ Negro. We do Spanish hip hop. And he brought us the demo of what eventually became La Recta Final.
La Recta Final.
When I met him, he was a little kid like this, very small. He was very, very fast, very intelligent, very creative. And for his age at that time,
Traer este negocio, en realidad, fue bastante difícil porque lo que traía era muy diferente, era algo nuevo.
Cuba, Miami, ya, ya, ya.
Y yo, el deseo de escucharme, escuchar mi voz con un ritmo y que la gente lo pudiera oír y pudiera grabarlo y lo pudiera poner para darle para atrás, darle play, que es como el, es más o menos el feeling de haber tenido una grabación. Eso pues me motivaba.
There were other movements taking place in the late 80s and early 90s, and one of them was the hip-hop en español thing that started happening in Puerto Rico with Vico C. But the other big thing was the movement of reggae in Spanish in Panama.
Reggaeton started in Panama. They took the dancehall sound, they took the reggae sound, and they added Spanish language lyrics to it.
A lot of songs that Jamaicans had done were getting like done over, but not the same words, but just with the same melody, with the same beat, with a Spanish guy or a Panamanian guy spitting something over it that kind of sounded good to him.
A producer in Jamaica named King Jammy made a, what they call in Jamaica, rhythms with a drum machine instead of using a whole band. And what he did is he took a very basic, cheap, almost like toy-like Casio keyboard drum machine that you could buy for like $100 in the store, and he just turned it on and put one of the presets on. And that became the most revolutionary rhythm in Jamaican music history.
There's one beat that's really came up maybe 85, 86, which was on it's a song called Dembow. And that beat became known as the Dembow beat. Dembow, Dembow, which means they bow, which is a sexual reference to guys who give oral sex to women, or women who give oral sex to men.
That was a huge record. It was a massive Jamaican hit. Then that beat from that record sort of became the foundation beat for 90% of all the reggaeton records that followed.
This guy called Edgar Franco comes to us and tells us, listen, I admire your work, you know, because he is great. I'm from Panama and I do Spanish reggae. We released El General, which was the first reggaeton record. It combined the influence of the Jamaican dembow with the Panamanian interpretation and the Panamanian flow.
Bueno, mi nombre es Edgardo Franco, mejor conocido como el Ragamuffin General. El General, y bueno, estoy cantando desde que tengo 10, 12 años, y reggae realmente entró en mi vida desde 1978. Nosotros agarrábamos los instrumentales que venían de Jamaica, y eran en 33, y nosotros lo acelerábamos a 45, porque era roots reggae, y así fue como el reggae empezó a tomar un poquito más de movimiento. Tenía un grupo que se llamaba Renato y la Cuatro Estrellas. Yo era una de las estrellas de ese grupo. Y Renato no hablaba español. Pero él se esforzó y dijo, yo tengo que oír reggae en español. Y él le dio y le dio y le dio. Y salió reggae en español.
When those two things combined, hip hop in Spanish in Puerto Rico, and what the Panamanians were doing with reggae, the kids just latched onto that. And that sound that came out of Puerto Rico with rapping on top of it was what ended up engendering reggaeton. They sped it up, they started playing with those rhythms, but it was all very underground.
Underground pretty much meant that it wouldn't get airplayed because the radio stations didn't want to play it. They say, this is not for radio, this is not music, this is garbage.
Because everything was just underground, underground, underground. They was talking dirty, they were talking everything.
And I can talk about girls' asses, and I can talk about fucking, and I can talk about shooting somebody in the head, and I can talk about slanging drugs, and I can talk about whatever I want to talk about, because you know what, that's our shit. That's our music.
Mi propio estilo cuando hablo, te hablo del tema, el catiche si te pega, te apunto y te rompo hasta el tiro para que no te intrometas y para que no jodas conmigo. Chelsea es mi nombre y no es nada raro. Acá mi pistola y tenés en la mano y si tengo candelo, no vas a tener mano.
So if you don't have a radio station that wants to play the angry, raw reggaeton, then the movement has to come up from the ghetto. The movement has to come up from the people that want to spread the word without having the normal channels of promotion and communication, with his radio, TV, whatever.
Prácticamente lo que hacíamos era reunirnos con el DJ en el cuarto de su casa, donde estaba, pues él tenía su equipo montado, que no eran más que dos platos MK1200, plato aquí, el otro acá, el mixer, Barón López con Discord, DJ Negro, también DJ Playero colaboró con nosotros al principio. De ahí surge básicamente el movimiento, la etapa del underground.
Entro.
Yo no salía a comprar equipo. Esto, antes los DJ cogíamos los equipos, uno de mira, préstame un turntable, al otro mira, préstame la bocina, al otro es préstame el mixer. Y juntando y cogiendo prestado y así, hacíamos un equipo y así comenzábamos a hacer los parties.
Playero, pues fíjate, lo conocí en el residencial Los Lirios en Santurce, como DJ. Me hacía, a veces tocábamos juntos en disco parties por ahí. Yo no podía hacer fiestas, él iba y los tocaba y cosas así.
Playero is a pioneer. He was the first DJ that came out with a whole bunch of guys throwing out lyrics in Spanish with reggae beats.
Playero used to do these cassettes, these underground cassettes, originally from his house, on a four-track cassette deck.
Pues aquí.
¿Dónde tú te sentabas? ¿Dónde era el estudio tuyo?
No, aquí mismo. Equipo. Aquí. Estaba puesto aquí. Aquí estaba puesto.
Y aquí. ¿Dónde
te sentabas? En el piso, en la silla, en cualquier lado.
Cuando yo empecé a grabar, y yo lo que hacía era acumulaba los acapelas, y yo lo seguía grabando. Llegó un momento que era tanta gente, tantos muchachos que aparecieron de yo no sé de dónde, de todos lados. Todos querían grabar, yo no rechazaba a nadie.
And he's one of the first guys to put out compilations, similar to mixtapes, where he would get a bunch of the local artists and he would put a compilation together. He was one of the guys that really pushed the genre.
Pues los artistas que pasaron por aquí, Daddy Yankee, Javia, Lázaro, Víctor y Cupa, que son Fela Rican King, Michael y Manuel Blanco, Ranking Stone, A.B. Queen, wow.
So many kids, very talented kids. The first artist he recorded on the cassette was Daddy Yankee.
One of the early reggaeton artists who worked in the underground, what they call the underground, which was reggaeton before it got discovered.
I come from San Juan. My barrio is Villa Kennedy, you know, like Kennedy's Village, you know, in English. And that's like one of the poorest barrios in Puerto Rico, so I grew up in that environment.
Well, he was a bit of a tough guy. He got shot. He still has some wound in his leg.
De allá empezaron a disparar. A lo loco. En el corre y corre, pues como te expliqué ahorita, Yankee brincó para allá y lo encontramos allá. Empezamos a buscarlo, que no lo encontrábamos, pues empezamos a escucharlo, ay, ay, llamando, ¿entiendes? El quejido. Y entonces, buscando, y cuando pues pasó aquí lo encontramos aquí. Lo levantamos y llevamos al dispensario, al hospital.
A lot of times when we were in the projects, it was that kind of environment. You never know what was going to happen, because most of the time something was going to happen. Either is somebody just fooling around and throwing shots in the air. The violence is very, it was, I think at the time, was very attached to the music.
You have to take it from its infancy, which is a subcultural, social type of movement. It was an angry type of a movement. I mean, these people were fed up. These people were always talking about shooting someone. They were very explicit lyrics.
Tal vez mi música no sea sana, pero yo no me inventé ni el sexo ni la marihuana para tojar a los que nos critican. Esta es la música con que los jóvenes se identifican.
So the kids start, you know, hanging out in the clubs, and the DJ is spinning all, you know, all the hip hop, all the house, all the freestyle. So the guys, you know, start thinking about, okay, give me the mic, let me sing, put the track. So all these things start in a club.
En Dinoy se tocaba, era una discoteca, una de las primeras discotecas de Puerto Rico, Dinoy. Ahí se escuchaba.
New York, Bellini.
Ahí vendían los cassettes.
Los cassettes, vendían los cassettes, ahí era cuando uno empezaba a escuchar en la discoteca.
¡Estos son piratas, piratas, piratas!
DJ Negro opened up D-Noise in Old Town.
Comenzamos a introducir entonces talentos de aquí.
When I met Negro, I had just came out of jail, and I had made a promise that I would go to his club, D-Noise. He made me start emceeing right there. And I had just written this song that had to do with Trabalengua. Ah, pues di esto. Seguiré demostrando, rependo, cantando, bailando, gozando, fumando, explicando, el mando que tengo que ser mi canima, a toda persona que oiga esa rima, que goce, que brinque, que salte y grite, que el mexicano no es mi muchacha, sino me que es lo que digo yo aquí, pongo atención, que siga así. He just stood looking at me and said, at 2 o'clock, you go out.
Llego un día a una discoteca con una canción que escuché en inglés, la hice una versión al español, que DJ Negro me dijo, vamos a grabarla. Al otro día la grabamos allí mismo en la discoteca, la empezaron a poner en la discoteca, se empezó a regar por la calle.
The way that they produced those albums was like, they get like all the instrumentals and loops, and they start calling all the guys from the club, yo, Michael, Manuel, come here, yeah. I got this piece for you, they start singing. DJ Negro used to finish one album in one day.
I call Negro the Quincy Jones of reggaeton. He was there. He got it all happening. Maybe not the most talented, but he knew how to market himself. He was the first one that marketed himself as a product.
No hacía música porque nunca quiso aprender a hacer música porque yo le quería enseñar. Pero era vago para eso. Lo de él era el negocio.
Y no, y a rayo, esto hay que tirarle fotos y guardarla ahí.
¿Negro qué hacía? Negro. Y vender lo que hacer.
Y si él se cagó y no sabes qué hacer, compra Charmin, compra Charmin.
And they would get an apartment, and everybody knew that's where you could go buy the tapes. that they were making, and they would record them at home. And it was all pretty low quality material. They created a sort of businesses around this.
I do like 10 copies of that tape. And like you said, I want to like sell it or something, but I know nobody know me. Who gonna buy this shit?
Y lo grabaron, lo ponemos un cassette player, una casetera, como dicen por ahí. Y lo íbamos duplicando y duplicando, duplicando, y así íbamos regando nuestra música. Por eso lo llamaban Underground. Underground porque era un mercadeo underground donde pues éramos nosotros mismos los distribuidores, los mismos que producíamos.
Todo esto estábamos en contra de que no había exposición en la radio. Simplemente lo que había era póster. Eso era toda la promoción de ese momento.
We take a bullhorn and we make like flyers. And then we go into every fiesta from Puerto Rico. And we start, yo, we're here. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Start screaming. And we make that noise for every town from Puerto Rico.
The thing about those early reggaeton recordings was that the music on them was technically illegal. Because what they were doing was taking beats off of U.S. hip-hop albums or Jamaican reggae albums and then putting them on their own tapes and then rapping over them, which was a complete violation of copyright laws. But, you know, they didn't know any better because that's all they had to work with.
When they're taking Public Enemy songs, they're taking Eurythmic songs, they were even extending beyond reggaeton. So, you know, there were songs that you would listen to them and they would be, you know, instant recognition, but all of a sudden somebody would be rapping about a local event that was going on.
This is a culture of poverty. You know, when you're poor, you're not thinking about how the law have to comply with the law. I'm trying to survive. But if I violate the law, sure, I'm violating it, but just, I'm not killing anyone. I'm not selling drugs. I'm just violating a copyright that belongs to someone. If I pay, I will be on the right side. So let me make some capital, some cash, and we'll see what happened next.
For a long time, the reggaeton tracks that were being made, they're awful. They're poorly produced, and the rhythm is the exact same thing on every track. That's it. They just came up with the one thing, and there you go. And everybody started rapping over that and creating their little personalities. A lot of it that's also related to salsa is the idea that I'm the best. You know, so there's a lot of bragging in these songs, right?
People made their music in studios and at home, and they just brought it in. And I've never said no to anyone. I took them on consignment, or we bought them, and we would sell them and introduce all these young kids today that are superstars. We introduced most of these kids.
And in a matter of weeks, they would sell, you know, 50, 60, 75,000 units, and it was all cash. No artist royalties, no mechanicals, nothing was being paid.
BM Records was the one who said, okay, you're selling a lot in cassettes, let's make it more bigger.
¿Qué pasa? Se dieron cuenta de que Playero, que eran los dos cocorotes, Playero y Negro, aquí no iba a buscar más nada, ¿entiendes? Eran esos dos. Estaban vendiendo un montón de discos.
Playero debe haber vendido más de 1.5 millones de copias. Aproximadamente.
Dice, y aquí llegó el OG Black y el Master Joe. Y aquí llegó el DJ Joe y el Master Joe. Y aquí llegó el OG Black y el Master Joe. Y aquí llegó el Escuadrón y el
Master Joe. They knew if they put in 20 songs mixed in a CD, everyone was gonna buy it. You never sold less than 3,000 or 4,000 in 2 or 3 weeks.
Ya yo había tenido una conversación con varios de los cantantes del disco. Ellos habían visto que Playero había cogido un dinero por el máster de Playero, por el 37, y que no le había dado ningún dinero a los cantantes. Entonces, como los cantantes se vieron que el hombre tenía dinero, las voces de ellos estaban en el disco estaba vendiendo, el disco, todo el mundo sabía que el disco estaba regado por todo Puerto Rico, ellos no recibieron ni un vellón de ese disco.
I don't think any of the artists felt like they were getting ripped off or felt like they were needed to go in there and get and pick up a check. They just wanted to be on those records.
There was no regulation. There was nobody to be able to say, yes, this is you, and we signed this contract and this and that. It's handshake deals. You come with me, let's do this here, blah, blah, blah. You know, bing, bang, boom, I'm giving you $500 for this or I'm giving you $1,000 for that, and inevitably you're gonna have a problem.
As anything in the ghetto, when it starts to grow, money starts to come into it, personality starts to come into it. then the drug dealers get involved. Because these are the guys in the ghettos that got money. So here he is, you know, whoever Mr. Big Man that, you know, drives a BMW and has a couple extra $1,000. And he's like, hey, hold on a second. These guys are more popular than I am. Everybody knows, you know, him more than me. So then he wants to start managing that kid.
It was easier for anyone who had a reggaeton CD to go to a drug dealer and get $100,000 than to go to a billion-dollar record company and try to get $5,000.
The majority of the rappers grew up with the drug dealers, for bad or good. And the drug dealer helped them to make the shows in the special projects as the caseríos.
The artist will be approached by whoever was controlling the project as the drug dealer. So, you know, you will go and play half of the show that you will normally play, get paid, and it was crazy because you could be counting $3,000 in $1 bills. I think drugs and violence is part of the culture. I mean, it's the same as with American hip-hop. They're talking about their reality, what they're seeing, and the shooting and drug dealing is their rice and beans, is their everyday life.
The government was checking why they're selling these cassettes in Puerto Rico, where they're coming from. Nobody knew, really.
It comes to the attention of the government because these cassettes were reaching the hands of minors. And all of a sudden, out of the door, the parent hears explicit sex, explicit lyrics.
Killing, I'm going to kill the cop, all these cops que me mamen huevo. I'm going to kill this cop que la policía me lo maman. That's how they used to say it. The government was pissed. Well, pissed with all these CDs that are coming out like that. Muchos me miran como si yo fuera un tipo sin arreglo. Como si nunca antes hubieran visto un negro. Como si fuera un delincuente. Como si con el lápiz y con mi libreta yo matara gente.
It was many parents that were telling the police, we cannot let our kids be contaminated with this music. An order must have come from somewhere to go and seize the product without a prior hearing, which is a violation of constitutional rights.
Que confiscaron todo el material que hubieron, arresto a los distribuidores, arresto a dueños de tiendas. Si mato a alguien, rápido me da toda la portada.
Y no me miren mal, cuida tu actitud, yo solo soy un portavoz. They came into my store, I said, this is a free country. You should be able to express what we feel. Okay, if you want to buy it, buy it. If you don't want to buy it, you don't buy it.
Lo que yo recuerdo fue que como a las 4 o a las 5 de la tarde tuvimos que correr al almacén, sacar todo lo de Dinoise Talk y Dinoise y Playero 37 y 38. Fueron 25.000 unidades que tuvimos que sacar de cassette y creo que 10.000 de CD, o sea que nos tomó hasta las 2, hasta las 3 de la mañana mover toda esa mercancía a una casa en Cagua.
You know, the funny thing about the tape seizures back then was that the government wasn't seizing the tapes because the music on them was illegal, because it was. They were seizing it because they thought they were dirty.
Contenido obsceno, o sea, pornográfico. Y obviamente, pues, muchas de las líricas iban hacia el estímulo del consumo de sustancias controladas y eso, pues, obviamente, y las personas eran bien jóvenes, eran jovencitos.
So the police were disproportionately targeting people that fit the rapero stereotype.
If you were in a car listening to this kind of music and a cop would catch you, they would stop you, confiscate your tape.
So it was zero tolerance in that. And even the kids, you know, their bags were searched. If they had tapes, they were confiscated.
Cuando nos enteramos que estaban confiscando las piezas porque pues la música no la querían en el gobierno, pues fue abrumador.
Artists were resentful that they were being targeted in that way. They were worried that a genre that seemed to be becoming more mainstream, its growth was going to be stunted.
In the beginning they say, no, the reggaeton is not good for Puerto Rico. But the people want reggaeton.
que esto fue a corte, o sea, esto fue una cosa bien grande que hubo.
The courthouse has to analyze the material and determine anybody cannot sell that or put that for sale in stores. But the police didn't do that. The police went without having a court order to do that, and that was the gist of the legal issue in the case. They had to go through the procedures before they seized the materials.
Fuimos a tribunal, ganamos el caso,
yeah.
y no tuvieron que volver todo para atrás.
Cuando cierra todo esto, que pasa el caso, el señor Pedro Mercedes y dice, yo no voy a trabajar ningún disco con este tipo de lírica, así que vamos a hacerlo todo clean lyrics. Y comenzaron a salir Dinois 3, Playero 39, con un sellito que decía Clean Lyrics.
Quiero cantarte, decirte con esto es verdad, pues demostrarlo a todas esas nenas que están ya esperando que Chesina comience a cantar, porque sabe que la vida va a cantar, no vamos a empezar.
Record sales for reggaeton did take a hit after everything that happened politically. It's almost like it all slowed down for the good, because everybody knew that they had to clean up their act and come back with real music, original music, and they knew that they couldn't count on just sampling anything. It was almost like a wash happened. And you know, in 1999 and 2000, things began to pick up again.
We did this record called Tumba La Casa. It was a Latin house record. That record was sampled by one of the most important DJs to me in reggaeton, which is DJ Nelson. He took this record of ours and he did a reggaeton beat with it and put it out on this record, and we loved it.
I want to go to New York at that time because I can get all the equipment that I need to do my music, you know? So I was going New York, back in Puerto Rico, New York, always. So I'm getting music, getting new music, getting new ideas.
Bueno, DJ Nelson fue uno de los productores que inteligentemente fue aprendiendo, se posicionó en un lugar bien chévere, fue de los primeros productores en tener su propio sello.
Hay otras personas bien importantes como lo es Coyote. Coyote siempre estuvo en diferentes emisoras.
Next 107.7, lo que escucha a esta hora.
Prendido.
Y el momento que yo entiendo de mayor alegría, yo entiendo que fue cuando nació Mix, la emisora, porque cuando ya se aprobó, vamos a hacer esta emisora 24 horas, los 7 días a la semana de reggaetón, pues ahí yo dije, mira, mano, esto es un palo, yo creo que de aquí partimos.
Bien duro con toda la tuca. Esta tarde a las 5 llega el Richie Rich.
Monster Mix.
Monster Mix, las muestras de Mix. Con toda esa música pesada, con las llamadas del público. Eso es hoy a las 5 de la tarde, bien prendido.
When Coyote launched Mix, it was an FM station in Puerto Rico that probably had, you know, no audience whatsoever. He basically took a station that nobody even knew what the dial was in Puerto Rico, 107.7, and just began playing reggaeton.
It became a hit. It was the number one radio station in PR, and that gave a second wind to the movement, you know?
Cousin of mine from Puerto Rico would come and like come visit us in Boston, and would bring all these tapes, underground music, just these guys spitting over these reggae beats, but in Spanish. We would like test it out, play records in the clubs, you know, to see how the crowd would react. I mean, the Latinos just went crazy. They just was, it was like they was waiting for a breakthrough.
Antes la música era un poco más rápida también, era un poco más rápida. Había todo esto cuando de un momento dado llegó DJ Blast y cambió todo el juego de la música.
Like I stopped the beat, I put it slow like I was real drunk, bro, 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 bro.
Y yo dije en mi mente, bueno, si eso se hizo lento, ¿por qué no hacemos un tema completo de una canción lenta? O sea, que sea un tema, que no sea un loop. Cuando salió ese tema, eso fue una bomba.
Vengan todas al baile, mujeres
So for a long time, reggaeton survived without getting off of the island, and those guys just selling it among themselves and doing it, but not getting much bigger than that.
Pero qué pasó, no existían videos, ¿entiendes? Aquí los videos que traían de programas de televisión que iban como el show de las 12, como Noche de Gala, y eso lo grababan en un tape, le ponían una letrecita y ese era el video musical.
Me fui yo caminando con mi radio, sacando muchas rimas, siempre sabio. Estoy yo aquí cantando, apagando la gente que de antes está cantando. Y digo solo.
Entonces vimos unos videos tipo Tula y Cruz que daban en Miami, este tipo de cosas. Y empezamos a trabajar esos videos así mismo en Puerto Rico, así. Las mujeres bikini, de espalda, nalgas por fuera.
Esto como yo estaba acostumbrado a la televisión, siempre uno busca un eye catcher, algo del gancho que te va a coger a la gente como un producto. Y pues qué pasó, me doy cuenta que las mujeres era clave esencial en los videos. Pero como salían bien sexy y culiando, como decimos nosotros, meneando las nalgas, y yo le pegaba la cámara ahí hasta home, a la gente le fascinó eso, será el palo, ¿entiendes?
Pues logramos hacer ese auge, pero creció tanto entre todos, o sea, porque hasta el abuelito quería ver el video, aunque la abuelita no. Pero entonces el papá quería ver el video, pero no dejaba al nene verlo.
Tú decías que iba a grabar un video en Carolina, casi todo era calle y barrio, y te iban allí 200, 300 personas, eso es un algarete, como decimos nosotros.
¿Qué edad tiene usted?
15.
¿Y por qué se atrevió a participar en una cosa como esta?
Porque mis padres me apoyan y me gusta mucho.
This guy, Héctor Marcano, that had another show in Puerto Rico, call me. Flaco, I gotta talk to you, come to my office, because something is gonna happen, and it's concerning you. You know, and you're gonna get in big trouble. Then the next day at 6 a.m. in the morning, my phone started ringing that I was on the cover of the paper, of all the newspaper in Puerto Rico. But they put my picture on it because we put minors almost naked on the music video.
Della González. Who is a very beloved woman in Puerto Rico, became very annoyed from what she was seeing.
Bailando en una forma, incitando al acto sexual más bien, y las letras de las canciones, eso era lo que decía. En un momento llegó una señora a mi oficina, que su hija se puso a ver un video y vio a la nena menor de edad bailando en uno de esos videos.
Bueno, tenía que ver con menores y obviamente algunas tomas. Bien sexualmente provocativa, donde la persona que estaba haciendo el acto pues aparentaba ser una menor de edad. O sea, eso era suficiente en Puerto Rico para crear un issue, aparte de del asunto de obscenidad.
Luego de mirar atentamente junto a sus asesores el videoclip del grupo Point Breakers, la senadora Belda González reaccionó al mismo.
Fue que yo empecé a preguntarle a las secretarias mías jóvenes, ¿qué es perreo? Y se miraban uno a la otra y decía, oh my Lord, you tell her.
Well, the dance of reggaeton is perreo. It simulates the intercourse between dogs.
Y empecé a llevar una cruzada desde la comisión que yo presidí en el Senado contra la violencia y el sexo en los medios de comunicación para que proteger a nuestra niñez y a nuestra juventud de esta influencia nociva que podía representar.
Well, she was like a witch for us. We hate that. We hate it. We want to be like hanging now. Gonna cut it up.
La vicepresidenta del Senado, Belda González, defendió hoy la constitucionalidad de los anteproyectos de ley sometidos.
Pues no, nos puso el dedo encima y nos hizo pues pasar otro sustito más en esto de lo que es el reggaetón como tal, porque nos quería sacar los discos de nuevo de las tiendas, nos querían sacar los videos de la televisión.
Este video fue el que causó la controversia total porque alegaban que la muchacha del video era una niña que era menor de edad. Hay una escena que habían hasta condones y hay un montón de cosas que estaban encima. Hay una escena que ella va bajando y yo estaba sin camisa. En su mayoría las preguntas siempre las hizo la señora Belda González.
La mujer que ha desenfundado su espada en este asunto del perreo es la senadora Belda González.
La señora Belda González me preguntaba mucho el por qué las canciones así, por qué no podíamos hacer temas que fueran mejor.
The irony of the scandal in 2001 is that it gave press to the artist. So folks that had not necessarily heard of reggaeton, then, you know, they knew that there was this genre that was creating a lot of controversy in Puerto Rico.
Lo que hizo fue que de repente estaban toda la gente de MTV, de CBS, de ABC, viendo este viniendo a cubrir esa controversia bien grande.
España de orientación dirigida a los padres.
Y no era que ellos querían censurar el reggaetón, sino Belda González lo que quería más bien era buscar la forma de que se cantara mejor, que los videos no fueran tan explícitos.
I'm very sorry for what Belda tried to do, because she tried to repress something too late in history. She was claiming that was on pornography, but from my thinking, it was a cultural challenge to her and to what she represents. By year 2000, the state was not capable of controlling reggaeton anymore.
Now I'm in the middle of the reggaeton. And you know something, during the last campaign, the people asked me to dance reggaeton because I told them, you can dance reggaeton nicely.
Que a la senadora Belda González bailando este género.
La música empezó, como te dije, en nuestras marquesinas y gracias a Dios, mira donde hemos llegado. Pero después que esa música...
So instead of holding it back, it promoted it even further. And I would say they did a great favor to the reggaeton movement.
We learned about that, so we start making more clean the music. More commercial, more, a little more serious about this thing.
There was a real specific strategy to clean up reggaeton. In other words, you want to get somewhere, stop using that language, sing about stuff that's a little more acceptable.
These guys took that whole scenario, and that's what's crossing it over.
Acuérdate que el reggaetón es una música de joven, siempre nos van a señalar y donde hay un joven siempre lo señalan. Así que si mañana los jóvenes cogen otra música que se llama el tacataca va a decir que trae droga y sexo.
Nosotros tiramos canciones un poco jocosas para la discoteca porque la gente, pues, ya que vienen los movimientos esos que tan corporales que de esto, pues pasa lo que pasa, pero a la persona le tiene que gustar porque si tú pones un cumpleaños, una música de Plan B que está hablando chica ven, bella, bella, no necesariamente esa gente van a bailar eso y se van a tener sexo. El sexo es algo que sale de la persona y todo el mundo lo tiene y es algo exquisito.
Pero el sexo es algo que sale de mil formas, de mil maneras, no tan solo con el reggaetón. Hay muchas maneras. Sin música pasa.
Yo puedo ser sensual, pero no puedo ser sexy, pero no hay que ser vulgar para apreciar una cosa sensual. Tú puedes ser sensual con una mirada, tú no tienes que desvestirte para ser sensual o ser sexy. Pues yo cambié la visión, el lenguaje visual. Cuando yo llego había un problema bien grave a nivel de los productores de video que hacían reggaeton. Lo hacían de una manera, ¿verdad?, que las expresiones visuales que uno veía, pues, eran sexuales, realmente sí. Porque las líricas las hacían literales, visualmente hacían literal lo que la lírica expresaba. Pero yo mejoré esa forma. Yo lo que hice fue que tergiversé el mensaje, cambié lo que ellos expresaban por unas imágenes diferentes, más artísticas.
Mi negrito bueno y ando sin miedo. Hey, se llenó el salón, soy dulzón. Boricua, demuestra si hay corazón. Pa' la pista, sacate la majarita, que con mi son él no claro la conquista.
Me ha dado el éxito para la sinceridad y la franqueza con que yo hablo y que yo las tiro como las veo, guste a quien no le guste y creo que eso le ha gustado hasta la gente que yo pues agredo en mis canciones, pues le gusta que yo les tire porque son los fanáticos que más yo tengo, son gente rara, gente de gabán, gente de oficina, gente así, gente mayor, que normalmente no apoyan este género.
La industria estuvo mucho tiempo creando imágenes. La industria estuvo mucho tiempo creando cosas que no existen. Ya llega un momento en que la gente, cuando ve que es algo es real, pues lo coge, lo adopta y permanece fiel a él.
I gotta give it up to Tego Calderon, because before this, reggaeton was just an underground thing. It was not commercial enough, it wasn't selling enough. Tego just took this to the next level. I mean, he was the one that really broke the door down so that all these other artists can really begin to make money and influence markets.
Yo creo pues que la gente pues se cansó de lo mismo. Yo creo que si ahora mismo sale un salsero feo así como Luis Vestidor, con un sabor cabrón y la pendejada, tumba a todos los que están.
I seen Tego at the Latin Hip Hop Summit and I told him, hey look man, I appreciate a lot for opening a lot of doors. Just like Fat Joe opened a lot of doors when he brought out Pun. I appreciate all that right there.
Tego broke the barriers as far as radio. Like I said, he brought something different to the table.
The one thing that Tego Calderon brought into this whole reggaeton genre was a social awareness. And this lyrical content had really been lacking for some time now. And, you know, they were also doing some really creative things in the studio.
Esa misma es la que yo necesito. Vamos a mezclar este mismo dembow bien duro, pero con estos ritmos old school, viejos, para ver si podemos traer algo nuevo. Y además de eso, pues también tenemos unas ideas bien fuertes, que es también traer un poco de la agresividad del rock al reggaetón.
Reggaeton has just grown beyond, you know, just being like a kind of Spanish dancehall. It's grown. It's got its own sounds now, and it's got its own, you know, features and flavors, and it's got its own characters. You know, it's got Evie Queen, it's got like the elder statesman who's like a Tego, and it's got, you know, like the young hot kid, Daddy Yankee, and you know, it's got their own producers.
Ahí vemos los Looney Tunes, los genios de lo que es el género del reggaeton. Estos muchachos, verdaderamente, la historia es impresionante como ellos comenzaron.
Los Looney Tunes. And we don't sing. We don't sing, we don't do shows. We only make music in the studio.
Que yo te besé.
Abre la canción, cierra eso. Cierra eso. Abre.
They pretty much work with all the reggaeton artists. Like, you want to hit, you go see Looney Tunes.
Looney Tunes marcaron un estilo, un profesionalismo en lo que es la musicalización. Empezaron a poner violines, empezaron a poner cosas en el reggaeton.
They are probably the most well-known at this point producers in the business. These guys are like major pioneers in terms of the sound. They're the ones that kind of create a trend with, okay, they're gonna use this snare beat or, you know, this kind of bass. People follow a lot along the pattern that Looney Tunes created in terms of the music.
Francisco Saldana and Victor Cabrera, they're just the tag team. They're originally from Dominican Republic, but they actually grew up in Boston. And they're really an American success story. You know, they came from really poor upbringing, and they beat the odds. They made themselves into the biggest producers in reggaeton.
Those guys worked before in Harvard University in the kitchen. Looney made the recipe with the chef, and Tunes washed the dishes.
From the beginning I moved to Boston, I always had in my head going back to Puerto Rico. That was my plan. Working to make money to get the enough technology, so I go to Puerto Rico with my own studio.
1999, I met Looney, Francisco at that time, right here in Carolina. He came from Boston with this kid, Victor, that's Tune. So they started, you know, like helping me out in the studio with this guy,
Noriega.
DJ Nelson was like the number one DJ, like the biggest producer. He's been all the time. The one who teach me to a lot of things.
Fue la primera vez que yo te toqué. Fue la primera vez.
I had what he wanted. I had the acapella. You know, I knew I went there for that. They wanted the acapellas. I'm like, oh, you gotta give me reggaeton blues. You gotta teach me. You gotta let me see your studio.
And I started looking Francisco face and Victor. I said, yo, you look like fucking cartoons. I wanna call you, yo, the Looney Tunes. And they say no. But the next day, they, you know, they came to the studio and say, yo, you know what? I like thy name. So everyone was calling Looney Tunes.
We were working at the studio. We were doing like Tego's album. For the first time, Tego was making an album. So everybody used to go in there and come out, and this thing was getting big. So they stole from the studio. That was a big, big problem we had with the rappers.
We almost got killed because of that. Yeah.
They stole Tego's album from my studio, like all the track that I was doing.
Yeah, five songs.
And the track was all over Puerto Rico. Tego was crying.
So everybody was mad at us. So we're like, oh, that's it for us. You know, like.
Even Yankee, one day he went to the studio. He's like, for the first time, he was going to give us a chance to work with him. And it was this mess in the studio. Everybody, oh, no, I lose one of my tracks in the studio. This is messed up.
So he lost.
And then he's like, oh,
he lost interest.
If you guys doing that, I don't want to work here.
Yeah.
He just told me that like that. And I was like, oh, it's like that, okay.
And it wasn't even our fault.
We never found who really did it, so.
But we have an idea, we just don't want to say anything.
Yankee actually ended up changing his mind and decided to work with Looney Tunes on creating Gasolina, and it became a huge crossover hit.
Gasolina, I mean, that was an all-Spanish record, but I think there isn't a single kid in America who can't sing that hook.
After I played Gasolina for the first time, then all these other stations started to play it. It became a top 10 Billboard chart hit. Daddy Yankee's the first artist in the reggaeton genre to receive platinum status.
Barrio Fino, ¿verdad? Después de tantos años, es el primer disco que se coloca número uno en los Billboards, rompiendo récord de venta en menos de un mes, 200,000 copias. ¿Entiendes? Que eso es un logro.
It has a big impact. So now the record companies see this, and now corporate America wants in.
Clear Channel started with these urban formats, which was a mix between Hispanic and urban. You know, having DJs that did my flow, speak in English, you know, throw in some Spanish.
Check out the website at mega949.com para toda la información del mundo mega. It's Mega 949, Latino and proud.
The happiest day in our life was the day that Clear Channel said that they were going to turn these stations to urban formats. It was like, did you hear?
When a company like Clear Channel says, we're going to go with a reggaeton station, you better believe they're going to go mainstream.
Because of us playing the records on the radio, and because of all these DJs spinning it in the clubs, and you know, people from all the way back at the Noise and the Playero days, now you have these stars, you know, they're completely celebrity status, you know, sitting at the MTV Video Music Awards and walking down the red carpet like Daddy Yankee did and getting nominated for the first ever reggaeton artist for an MTV Video Music Award, you know, to Evie Queen, people like Calle 13 that are just like really reinventing it. People like Don Omar had a billboard in Times Square, New York City, for his CD. You know, that's a major accomplishment. Not everybody could say that.
Don Omar was the artist that reggaeton needed. He was the most versatile singer, songwriter that the genre had seen him.
Alrededor de 500,000 copias vendidas dentro de Puerto Rico, Estados Unidos, España, Europa y Centro y Sudamérica.
He's an improviser, and nobody has the melody of Yandel. So you have the perfect combination. You have a great rapper, a great improviser, mixed him with a guy who could really do a melody, you know, like nobody.
Mientras haya un movimiento, el reggaetón es la base grande. El reggaetón es algo universal, es algo que los productores en Puerto Rico han creado a ser universal.
Yo creo y pienso que el género va a seguir expandiéndose porque sigue entrando gente. Lo sientes cuando vas a Estados Unidos, que los latinos pues apoyan. Ahora también la gente que no habla español también está.
Sooner or later you're going to see more records that kind of mix up Spanish and English. They're probably going to pressure these artists to have more English in these songs. I think it's ultimately it's inevitable.
It's the kiss of death for any Latin music to try to go to English. It's the worst thing that could happen to any genre. The fact that people speak Spanish is a rhythm in itself. The whole cadence and structure of English is different. It falls on different beats. The words don't have the same crackle and the accents don't fall in the same way. To put reggaeton in English and make it work, very difficult. I have yet to find one single example where it works.
Aquí fue que empezó el reggaeton en los caseríos, la música que antes nadie la quería, todas las clases la obviaban, pues aquí fue que empezó. Estas fueron las primeras personas que nos dio la oportunidad. Ya tú sabes, yo digo que son el piso de lo que es reggaeton.
Reggaetón como tal, yo siempre lo he visto como un complemento que se ha convertido en algo muy importante porque es esencia hip hop, pero con un sabor más compatible con el Caribe, con el latino en general.
Nacional, nos sentimos orgullosos de representar a todos los latinos en todo Centroamérica y a todos los latinos en Estados Unidos, ya tú sabes, esto es el siguiente movimiento que se va a quedar con el canto, ya está pasando.
Admiro a Tego Calderón. Admiro a Eddie D, no porque hayan sido los que grabaron conmigo, precisamente los grabaron conmigo por eso. Son los que admiro verdaderamente. Admiro a Daddy Yankee por su consistencia en el ambiente. Como creyente no me gusta que me consideren ídolo, porque eso viene de la palabra idolatría. Y como creyente, pues, me incomoda, pero lo entiendo como artista, lo entiendo como figura pública, porque yo personalmente tengo lo que consideramos ídolos en el campo artístico.
Pudiera decir, como voy a cantar otra cosa que no fuera bachata, me fascina el R&B, hip hop, pero el reggaetón me fascina también.
Estamos pasando por lo mismo que pasó el hip hop en sus comienzos. Y como yo conozco el hip hop desde que empezó, todo lo que el hip hop ha pasado, todos sus ataques, imaginaciones, estos grandes artistas americanos, y con todo eso lograron vencer todo lo que mucha gente, ¿verdad?, decía del género, pues así mismo está pasando el reggaetón y yo sé que nosotros vamos a estar a un nivel que ni la gente se imagina que vamos a llegar, pero yo sé que esto es el comienzo.
Ahora los números, they make sense. Census report comes back, they say, hey, Latins are no longer minority, they're majority. It makes sense. So, you know, now that these numbers make sense and we got a little more business minded, we got a little more business sense, it's time to take advantage of this opportunity and take this to the top right here.
I think it's my music too.
El talento que nace de mi barrio
es talento de oro, que pesa, del fino como mi gente, un talento que siente como el corazón, porque de ahí es que nace, y desahoga todo lo que ha vivido en las calles, con canciones, con consejos, con poemas y con historias, como la historia verdadera de los que se han levantado del barrio, haciéndose dueño de su orgullo humilde. Y permítame decirles que yo tal vez he llorado, pero son más los momentos que me he fajado, que he luchado, y de más está decirles que lo que he alcanzado se lo dedico a este lugar donde me he criado. Sí, yo, Gavilán, soy del barrio. Eso sí que es un talento. Salir de aquí es mi mayor reconocimiento, y llegar a donde quiero será mi agradecimiento.